Hi, everyone, and welcome back for the second part of this lecture. And so this second part, I will introduce some of the concepts and tools that we need to be able to estimate heritability using individual level data. So more precisely, I will try to emphasize actually a key concept that which underlie a number of methods for estimating heritability, and also going to introduce the concept, the genetic relationship matrices, which are instrumental for the type of inference we want to do. So remember that in the first part, I introduced the following equation that, you know, which relates the correlation between the finite correlation between relatives on the left-hand side of that equation to the heritability H squared through that coefficient of genetic relationship Rij. And so in part one, I haven't defined properly what is Rij, and here I'd like to do that. So this Rij parameter or coefficient of relationship has a formal definition, and it is defined as 2 times a probability. And so what is that probability? So imagine that you can observe the DNA of two individuals, and you look at a particular position of their DNA, their genome. So this, let's say a locus, you look at this locus, and you want to know at a particular locus, you have a set of alleles, you know, people have different forms of DNA, different sequences there. And the question is, if you take two alleles at random, one in individual I and one in individual J, what is the probability that those two alleles are identical by descent? So what does it mean by identical by descent? It's not just that they are similar, in this case, they will only be identical, but identical by descent means that they're not only similar, but they can also be traced back to a single common ancestor. So this is a picture that I picked up on Wikipedia. And so if what you look here is that in this pedigree, they've highlighted this small segment, orange segment, which is identical between that individual and that individual. But more than that is that if we trace back in the pedigree, we can see that this orange segment comes from one of their grandparents here. So again, this RJ is defined as 2 times the probability that two alleles picked up at random in individual I and individual J are identical by descent. So that gives us the formal definition of the coefficient of a relationship. So that definition is highlighting that to be able to quantify this coefficient, we'll need some pedigree information. And so in this example, we know that the pedigree, and we can kind of come back, trace back that information. But this is quite challenging, because having both pedigree information and DNA information simultaneously is pretty rare. So we can, in theory, based on certain assumptions, we can derive for certain types of relatives, we can derive what is the expected value of that probability. For example, in part one, I gave that the expectation of the coefficient of relationship for full sibs was 0.5. And we can do the same thing for example, parent offspring relationships, or avuncular relationships, for example, between an uncle and a niece. And we can do that to a certain extent, but it becomes challenging quite rapidly. So I'll come back to that challenge in a minute, but just wanted to emphasize that, again, we have something which is instrumental here, at least to correlate to, it teaches us, it suggests a way that we could use that information to estimate heritability, but it just highlighted this challenge around quantifying this Rij. So, but before trying to address this challenge in a different way, I'd just like to emphasize that we actually at the core of the issue here, because most of the method for estimating heritability, I will talk at least the ones based on individual level data. So in this lecture, I will cover two, the most popular of them, and you'll see that in the literature, there are many, many more of those methods out there, but they all gravitate around the same, utilizing that relationship here, that the correlation between relatives or the covariance between relatives on the phenotype side can be in a somewhat linear fashion be related to the genetic relatedness. And so how those different methods will vary is essentially by the way they will combine that information, the way they will utilize the covariance on the phenotypes and the genetic information on the other hand. And I'll try to illustrate that in the next part. So coming back to the challenge, before I would just like to introduce what is the genetic relationship matrix, and I'll be talking about GRMs throughout the remaining part of this lecture. And so what is the genetic relationship matrix or GRM? It is a matrix, right? Okay, it's a table with a number of rows and a number of columns, M, just arbitrary dimension. And what are in this matrix? Oh, in this matrix, we have coefficients of relationships. So it's as simple as that. The genetic relationship matrix is a matrix of genetic relationships. So GRMs can be quantified based on expected IBD sharing. So what I was talking about earlier, we can know based on knowing the pedigree relationship between people, we can derive what is the expected coefficient of relationship and fill the matrix this way. But in order to do that, we'll need to know what is the pedigree relationship between everyone in the sample, again, which is challenging. And the revolution is coming from the fact that we can actually do that instead using a SNP data. And so there are many ways to calculate a GRM using SNP data. In fact, there's actually almost an infinite way of doing that. And the reason why there are different that many, although I will just focus on the standard estimator of GRM, is that, well, these different methods will differ in the way they will give, they will weigh the SNP information coming from different chromosome or either coming from some prior biological knowledge. You can try, because you have access to you can access the sequence, you can play around and give information as you want, and therefore build the relationship matrix in an infinite number of ways. So we are trying to be as more agnostic as possible, and I will introduce in the next slide a standard estimator of relatedness, which happens to be implemented in the software GCTA, which I will try to teach you over this workshop. So what is the standard estimator? So the standard estimator is defined by this equation. So we have this pi hat jk. So this is one of the entries of this matrix. So we have individual j and individual k, right? So row, columns, or columns, row, it doesn't matter. So you look at this matrix and you look at what is the jk entries, and that's denoted here as pi jk. So we have here about m SNPs. So small m is the number of SNPs that we have to estimate a GRM. And we also introduce a notation with pi I, which is the minor allele frequency of SNP I. And we have m of them. So this pi jk is essentially an average, right? We're averaging across the SNPs, one divided by the number of SNPs, and we're summing across the number of SNPs, and we're averaging those quantities. And those quantities are essentially looking at minor allele count for individual j. So this is something that takes value into 0, 1, or 2, depending on whether you have zero copies of the minor allele, one copy of the minor allele, or two copies of the minor allele. And so same for xik for individual k. And those terms here are essentially a correlation, looking at what is the correlation, the sort of the degree of sharing or between individual j and individual k at that particular SNP. So we calculate that for all the SNPs, and then we average across all the SNPs we have disposal. So here I just wanted to give you an example. This is based on a simulated data set with unrelated individuals. And so the type of, once you calculate the GRM and you will try to, you hopefully play around with a few GRMs during this workshop, but you can have a look at some of the entries in those matrices. And you see here that for essentially the three individuals, so one is the relatedness of individual one with themselves. And so you see it's just about one, it's a bit different from one. And we have here for 2-2, is bits larger than one, and 3-3 as well. So relatedness of individual with themselves is about 1.1, but we also have the cross relationship between which are valued here. So one thing that we can observe is that, well, we in that matrix we have relatedness that are can be a bit larger than one for people with themselves, and we can also have negative values, right? So this is an observation. And that's because this is an estimator, but we can say something about the distribution of that estimator. So what we want is to estimate the level of genomic relatedness between individuals. But what happens if we have a large number of relatives, and what can we say about the mean and the variance of those quantities? So what we know is that the expectation over a large number of, you know, of relatives is that the expectation of this pi hat jk in our GRM is exactly what we wanted to estimate, is the this rjk. So for example, these are again data from the UK Biobank. And so you have here on the x-axis different types of relatives, and here on the y-axis you have the values of their GRMs. So you see here that the horizontal dotted lines in red are the expectations. For example, for MZ twins, we expect one of a coefficient of relationship of one, and we see that on average we are exactly at one with a little bit of variation. And here we also see for full SIBs that we expect 0.5 with a slightly bigger, well, a significantly bigger variation here, and as well for other type of relatives. So the point here is to say that the expectation of the GRM is exactly the coefficient of relationship in the way it was defined formally, you know, again, we're based on IBD as well. And we also observe an interesting thing here is that the GRM seems to bring us an additional information, and I'll try and substantiate in 1 minute why it is an additional information, but it brings some additional information because we see that we have actually more variation in terms of genetic sharing or level of genomic sharing or resemblance between full SIBs than only what we would have expected based on the pedigree information. So based on the pedigree information, would have predicted that, oh, well, those full SIBs should have a relatedness of 0.5, right? That's what it should have had. And what we observe here is that actually we have a range of values. So one can argue that, well, this range of value is because, sampling, this is an estimator, it estimated, it has some variation. But in fact, the sampling variation of the GRM is fairly, fairly small. In fact, that sampling variation is a function of the number of SNPs that we're using. So obviously, if we're trying to use to estimate that GRM on a small number of SNPs, would expect a large variation. But here, those estimates were obtained with millions of SNPs. So therefore, the sampling variation, in the sense of the variation between SNPs, is actually not as large to explain that variation that we observed here. So the variation that we observe is actually true. It is showing that within a family, that certain siblings will be more similar genetically to others. And that's because of biological phenomenon known as recombination. Right, so just to summarize, observing simultaneously the correlation between, phenotypic correlation between relatives and a measure of genetic similarity is the key for estimating heritability. And all the methods are exactly using that relationship in different ways, but they are using that relationship to come up with ways to estimate heritability. Secondly, we've shown here that GRMs can be quantified using actual data, and that they actually show more variation than expected under the pedigree relatedness. And this is actually good it comes with a lot of nice statistical properties, and in particular in terms of reducing sampling variance of this estimator. And and finally, I'll briefly mention the name of that software, and in the next part I will expand a bit more on that, but there are software out there, GCTA is one of them. You probably heard about Plink for running GWASs and quality control of genetic data. Plink also has now imported some of the functionalities of GCTA for calculating GRMs, but we'll be focusing on GCTA for that practical. But yeah, software like GCT or Plink can calculate GRMs and use them for estimation of heritability, which will be our next topic for part three. So thanks again for your attention. I hope you're enjoying what we're doing together and building a bit more knowledge. And I'll see you in part three.